طارق الباز طبعا غني عن التعريف. كان رئيس اسم الكلى في الازهر، كان رئيس جمعيه الكلى للمرضى وزراعه الكلى، والحقيقه دايما بيدينا
اتفضل دكتور طارق. ثانك يو فيري ماتش مستر تشيرمان. دكتور ماهر فؤاد، اي ثانك يو فيري ماتش فور ذيس انفيتيشن، وفي حفاظه على keeping identity بتاعت الجمعيه all over the years by this wonderful gathering. الموضوع اللي هنتكلم عليه النهارده is purely clinical. I'm sure all of you are quite aware and oriented about what I have to say. I'm not going to go in depth like Professor Sabri, but rather a very comprehensive overview. I'd be happy to listen to any questions, ask any, answer any questions about that. Well, the post-transplantation metabolic sequelae, what I could think of, are related to diabetes, hyperuricemia, and dyslipidemia. Naturally, all of these three clinical entities are also related to end-stage renal disease, and allow me to take you briefly over the coming few slides about the situation of these metabolic sequelae in relation to end-stage renal disease, and remind us all how much diabetes is becoming the commonest cause of end-stage renal disease all around the world, as you can see from the graph and from the data below. Although we have a lack of data about the etiology of end-stage renal disease in developing countries, including our country, and we are definitely doing efforts about it these days, yet, according to this recent publication, diabetes mellitus and hypertension are also the leading causes of end-stage renal disease in this part of the world. لما نعرف أن diabetes is souring and reaching about 35% in our population. The bad thing about diabetes is diabetic patients do very bad on dialysis, whether hemodialysis or peritoneal dialysis, and this is just the same whether in developed or developing countries. The incidence of patients who develop end-stage renal disease due to diabetes appears to have stabilized in Denmark, and this publication was very old, in the year 2006, implementing, due to the implementation of the renal protective measures, hypertension control, dyslipidemia control, and definitely diabetic control. And this is very important quotation that gives us hope that the more we control diabetes, we are going to really prevent the progression, and this publication is old. There are a lot of publications after this within the same context. So do your best to control diabetes in your patients. Hyperuricemia and CKD, for a long time we've been knowing that there's a risk. It's the risk factor for renal insufficiency in the general population, and it's even regarded as a poor prognostic factor for the development of renal insufficiency in those patients who develop the IgA nephropathy. Rick Johnson, who has visited Egypt several times, has been working a lot with uric acid, showing a close relationship between hyperuricemia and hypertension. And just a couple of years ago, there was a publication about treating adolescent hypertensive hyperuricemic patients with allopurinol, but there is no justification up to this day to extrapolate these data to the others. Yet, the relationship has been histopathologically proven between hyperuricemia and hypertension, not to mention that it's also a cardiovascular risk in the general population. Coming to this dyslipidemia and CKD, this is a bit gloomy because all the randomized controls trials to date have not shown any significant benefits with statins in these patients. But there are extrapolations of these data, or explanations rather than extrapolations, saying that this is possibly happening because doctors are not able to aggressively use statins in this cohort of patients for the fear of the complications. Also, the cholesterol phenotype in uremic patients is different from the general population. Also, we have to bear in mind the poor compliance in the field of the statin-related side effects. All of these factors are related to why statins are not that effective in these patients. Not to mention that the Aurora trial and another three mega trials did come to the conclusion not to use statins at all for patients who are on dialysis. Now, moving to the post-transplant metabolic sequelae, let me start by the NODAT or the new onset diabetes after transplantation. I'd like to tell you it is a serious and frequent metabolic complication for patients who are receiving renal transplant or any solid organ transplantation because more or less the same drugs are used. NODAT patients have similar complications just like type 2 diabetes. But the bad thing about this form of diabetes is that these complications have a tendency to accelerate regarding their complications, and there is a higher risk of the major cardiovascular events, graft failure, death sensor graft failure, and death. So it is not an easy complication to happen, and we should really be on the alert when it does. Regarding the incidence, the literature is full of a very wide spectrum from 2% to 25% occurrence. But let me say that the incidence of NODAT greatly depends on the length of the follow-up and also the diagnostic criteria. If you're going to use a kind of lax type of diagnostic criteria, you're going to miss a lot of these patients. Well, the most accurate incidence to date of NODAT under CNI therapy, which is the major inducer of NODAT, is 20.5% within the first 6 months. After that, after 6 months from transplantation, the annual incidence of NODAT would be similar to that observed in patients on the waiting list and on dialysis, which is around 6%. How are we going to diagnose NODAT? Initially or before maybe 10 years ago, the requirements of insulin for a minimum period of post-transplantation up to 30 days was enough to diagnose NODAT. But this is no good because maybe a patient does not need insulin yet he is hyperglycemic, so he's going to be missed in diagnosis. Since the year 2003, we've been using the diagnosis submitted by the American Diabetic Association, and it was based on the usual diagnostic criterion related to type 2 diabetes mellitus. Now, we are even more strict, saying that a fasting blood sugar more than 100, which is not yet a diabetic patient, meaning that this is an impaired glucose tolerance, is enough to put you on the alert. This patient is a NODAT and you should start to actively treat. We do not use the A1C in follow-up, maybe in diagnosis, but maybe in follow-up, and we understand why, just like in patients on dialysis, because the fluctuations of the A1C related to the possible associated anemia due to blood loss or whatever immunosuppression leading to bone marrow disturbances and anemia. The risk factors of NODAT are those like the risk factors shared with type 2 diabetes mellitus, as you can see in this slide, including HCV, which is known to all of us, causing disturbances in the signaling of insulin, while there are specific factors related to transplantation. If we are going to use higher doses of steroid, even pulse steroids, when we give pulse steroids, initially, this is a factor to be considered, and also when we are facing an episode of acute rejection and we need to pulse the patients, this also is a risk factor. CNIs, naturally, cyclosporin and tacrolimus are on top of the list of the diabetogenic drugs, and we all know that tacrolimus is much more diabetogenic than cyclosporin, although it is better in immunosuppression. Sirolimus, which was first initially thought a very calm drug with no complications, has been also shown to be diabetogenic and also have nephrotoxicity. Now, there are claims that CMV infections may also be related to the occurrence of NODAT through disturbances of the insulin signaling, but there is no currently in the literature something to really document this point. Regarding the management, patients should be screened for the risks of the occurrence of diabetes before transplantation, just to put you on the alert. And there is lack of data showing that immunosuppression tailoring from the beginning in such patients would prevent the occurrence of NODAT. So you really don't have to tailor from the beginning, but just screening your patient. Immunosuppression should take into account the immunological risk of the patient while you are reducing these drugs to avoid acute rejection. You're going to treat diabetes and lead to an acute rejection. So you should take care about this. You treat patients with NODAT just like patients with any other form of diabetes, but you would like to avoid the first generation sulfonylureas that may accumulate. These patients, although they have normal renal functions, they do not have a normal clearance, as we all understand, and this may predispose to hypoglycemia. Also, the bioguanides, we may fear the occurrence of lactic acidosis, so better to refrain. All the other drugs, including the recent comer, the DPP-4 inhibitors, are used in transplantation safely with all forms of insulin. Moving to the second point of post-transplant sequelae, which is hyperuricemia, the PTHU, post-transplant hyperuricemia. It is quite common in patients after kidney transplantation. It is not uncommon. And although there is an increase in the uric acid, it may represent a decrease in the transplant function. Yet, hyperuricemia is even reported in patients with intact transplant function, and it could be related to CNIs, for example, particularly cyclosporine. Now, the recent findings suggest that the uric acid levels are independently associated with cardiovascular system events and are related to mortality, and they have been in this publication and further publication related to the long-term transplant survivor. So it is not something to be overlooked in the post-transplant period. We should treat hyperuricemia. The associated factors leading to this is definitely cyclosporine therapy and occasionally the use of diuretics, which potentiates the actions of cyclosporine. And not to forget that our patients may have a high prevalence of the metabolic syndrome, NODAT, and all of these clinical situations would be associated most of the times with hyperuricemia. Gout, yes, can happen. It is not uncommon at all in transplantation. Gout behaves similarly to gout in other settings, but the prevalence is not low. It's from 2 to 13%, and also these variations are due to various data collection. The onset of gout may occur within month of transplantation, and you will be surprised that it may occur even after years. If a patient is receiving diuretics, which is occurring so frequently, this may heighten the incidence of gout, particularly in patients taken or treated by cyclosporine. When you have such a condition and you have gout, you should consider to reduce the cyclosporine doses, and the levels diminish with time. This is a fact. And even with diminished cyclosporine levels, as the post-transplant period steadies and goes forth, even with lower doses of cyclosporine, gout has been described and is seen. So the risk of gout would rather depend on the exposure to cyclosporine rather than the level or the dose. And this is, of course, variable from patient to patient according to the genomics, pharmacogenomics of this particular patient. There are some interesting qualitative differences in gout occurring in the post-transplant period than in the general population. There is a predilection for proximity, proximal distribution of gouty arthritis. We don't see in the general population so much affection of the hips and shoulders and sacroiliac joints. Of course, if a patient has a tophus, a tophi, this speaks of gout, doesn't need any problem, but tophi are really serious and problematic to treat, particularly if they erode the overlying skin and drain cutaneously. these lesions in immunocompromised patients are susceptible to infections and sepsis and so forth. How are we going to treat gout when colchicine is a drug that has been used for ages in treating gout, and you may use it at the conventional dose of 0.6 milligrams, but we should understand, although it is potent and effective, colchicine resides in its ability to induce a very serious complication. I know that this complication reverse back to normal, but we are dealing with an immune-compromised patients and we really are not sure of the outcomes. The myoneuropathy, where there is speculations within the muscles associated with neuritis, is a serious complication of colchicine, not to mention the gastrointestinal complications related to the drug itself. NSAIDs have been used and maybe are one of the causes why patients who had hyperuricemia in the pre-transplant period also have interstitial nephritis. You can use them if you can really be sure that you are monitoring the patient, no added risk factors that may potentiate the occurrence of complications such as hypertension or diabetes. Maybe the COX-2 inhibitors are less deleterious or harmful, but I would be cautious about using these forms of drugs in general in a patient who has received a transplantation. Steroid seems to be a good drug. It is anti-inflammatory, as we all know. Already the patient is on steroids, but you would like to increase the dose to a level of 0.5 to 1 milligram per kg for a short period of 3 to 7 days just to control the inflammation. I'm sure we all realize that allopurinol, the wonderful xanthine oxidase inhibitor, is contraindicated, particularly if a patient is taking ASA. This is inviting bone marrow depression, so please never do this. The patients who are on ASA are not so frequent nowadays, but we have to state this as a fact. Fluvoxostat, of course, this newcomer, which is a non-purine xanthine oxidase inhibitor, is better than allopurinol, that you can use it in mild cases of renal insufficiency, and its sufficiency lowers the uric acid levels just like the allopurinol, and this recent publication showed that it has effects which are significant in treating hyperuricemia in patients, but don't get over enthusiastic about this drug and its safety. It may produce complications just like those of allopurinol. This is an old publication, but just to remind us that our hypertensive patients are sometimes treated by amlodipine, which is good in the essence of a patient having hyperuricemia because it increases the GFR, and this would enhance the excretion of the uric acid from renal tubules. So if you're going to use it in treating a hypertensive hyperuricemic patient, this is an added value. The last point, which is post-renal transplant dyslipidemia, I have to say the 60% prevalence of dyslipidemia was higher than that before. It was around 80%, and it usually occurs within 1 month of initiation of immunosuppressive therapy. The three major drugs that are involved in its occurrence are the cyclosporin, sirolimus, and steroids. Cardiovascular disease is the leading cause of mortality after organ transplantation and accounts for more than 30% of death. And there is a causal relationship with cardiovascular mortality. There isn't a causal relationship with cardiovascular mortality related to dyslipidemia. No one has ever proven this, but you can extrapolate a patient with dyslipidemic and ongoing atherosclerosis. It must have an impact on the cardiovascular integrity and morbidity, which may lead to mortality. Looking to this graph, you can appreciate that a patient, the blue line, with a kidney transplant, has also problems related to the cardiovascular mortality, much higher than the general population, highly significant as a matter of fact, but dialysis, we all understand why, is much more. The pathogenesis of cardiovascular problems after transplantation involves transplant-specific factors like those here, duration of the pre-transplant end-stage renal disease. He has a very bad vasculature, he was on dialysis for a long time, the presence of NODAT, hypertension, or even poor allograft function. And maybe this diagram shows you and sums everything together, and you can see on this side of the graph Here the immunosuppressive drugs leading to dyslipidemia, hypertension, and hyperglycemia, and all these have an impact on the integrity of the endothelium. The etiologies of dyslipidemia and transplantation among the immunosuppressive agents and the mTOR and the cyclosporine, we should not forget the diet and the obesity, which is happening after transplantation. Naturally, genetic predisposition is always there. A point of noteworthy that mTOR inhibitors would lead to a significant increase in both the cholesterol, triglycerides in a dose-dependent pattern, possibly through a decrease in the catabolism of the apolipoprotein with inhibition of insulin and insulin-like GF signaling. And this is how this disturbance happens. Sirolimus is very serious in causing dyslipidemia. How are we going to treat these patients? This is a very challenging thing. We should screen and screen these patients within 6 months of transplantation and after a year and so forth annually. And common agents to treat dyslipidemia, you can use everything, but there is also tahzirat. Fluvastatin and pravastatin, just a minute, please, or 2 minutes. Fluvastatin and pravastatin are the safer statins to be used. Yes, you have to know they are safer, but they are less potent than others. Rosuvastatin, for example, has been associated with an increased proteinuria and renal failure at higher doses in the post-marketing report in the FDA in the year 2005. This is in the general population, so I cannot use it for a post-transplant patient. Also, statins are known to induce rhabdomyolysis, particularly for patients that are taking cyclosporine. So in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, the various post-transplant metabolic sequelae affect both the graft and patient's survival, and this is a fact. And pre-transplant screening is needed to detect patients for the pre-diabetic state. And the wise reduction of immunosuppressive is really a major challenge for the fear of acute rejection. So there's always a need of proper choice of therapeutic agents. You should understand the drugs you are going to use. You should have depth in the knowledge about these drugs and their interactions and adverse events. And I thank you all for your kindness.
Thank you, Professor Farah, for the intelligent presentation. And now we have short time for 3 questions. Thank you, Professor Farah, for the scenario. We usually say that the mask is more diabetogenic than cyclosporine.
Yes.
Does this statement still apply in view of the steroid-free protocols or periodic?
Does it still apply in what?
In the protocol of no early steroid withdrawal, when we stop steroids.
I don't have a straight answer to this, but if you allow me just to think it over, steroids combined with CMI would definitely lead to more diabetogenic effect, but tacrolimus one, it was looked at being a diabetogenic drug, it was looked in protocols with steroids and versus cyclosporine. So both of the drugs were compared to each other until there was a conclusion that it is more diabetogenic. These drugs did not address any reduction of steroids. This is what I can think of.
As far as I remember, there's two publications stated that the diabetogenic effect of tacrolimus markedly decreased when you stop steroids.
Definitely, because there's synergism. But when you compare tacrolimus to cyclosporine, this is the issue. I'm not saying that it is on its own or with steroids in comparison, just in comparison to cyclosporine.
So definitely, it's more diabetogenic than cyclosporine. Even withdrawal of corticosteroids, all the studies multivariate analysis with multi effect been less and is not effective. إنما هو هو يعني الانسولين الدايبيتس هيبقى أقل مع لما تسحب الاستيرويدز. لكن multivariate analysis كلها بتقول إنه
الدايبيتوجين. in America, in the whole campaign, in the absence of soils, most have the same effect on the
okay.
state.
كل الستاديز ما عدد
خلاص بقى
لا
بحبه كويس ما بيعملش
طب بس just few comments بالنسبة للميتفورمين
Metformin, yes, like
it's a very nice drug.
It is.
It's a very cheap drug.
Yes.
And it's actually a very good drug.
Yes.
And I think if the renal function, the graft, the renal function, the function of the graft is good, you can use it very safely.
Yes, sure.
This
sure.
is the level of the
drug. The same
as the 1.6 for males and 1.4 for females. يعني احنا بنتكلم في جي اف ار we were talking about جي اف ار you should reduce the dose when the جي اف ار is 60 and stop it when it is 30 I would do what Professor Gohan does or says also for a transplant patient if I am able to calculate the جي اف ار طبعا بس احنا ما بنحبش في الادوكيشن احنا to say this out loud although في publications بتقول يعني كرياتين اعلى من كده لكن المشهور واحنا قعدنا انا والدكتور كمان في لقاءات كتير قوي in this particular point about metformin it's a wonderful cheap drug very effective وكل حاجه لكن انا ما اعرفش اللاكتيك اسيدوزز if I ask the audience كم واحد شاف لاكتيك اسيدوزز I doubt ان في حد بيشوفه مش عارف ايه الكره الشديد للمفهوم والخوف منه.
لا ده في ناس كتير قوي طالعه
yes.
يعني بتقر وتحلف ان اللاكتيك اسيدوزز is very rare in patients.
Yes.
And up to 2 serum creatinine 2 or 2.5 you can use infection.
يا مش اسمك اسيدوزز بس يا مش اسمك اسيدوزز بس لان في ريبورتس جت سالت
في تايوان
ومن اماكن اخرى مورتاليتي. مورتاليتي اسوسيتد من افريلاكس اكسسيف داون.
النقطة اللي
بنقصي لاكتيك اسيدوزز يا دكتور حسين
معلش انا سمعت منك كلمة ما اعرفش يعني انا احب اعدلها شوية ان الالبرينول از كونترا انديكيتد تو ترانسبلانت
patients
who are receiving azathioprine انا فهمتها كده
yes I meant that
actually you can use azathioprine
decrease dose
but just to decrease the dose of azathioprine it's not an actually contraindication
should take care or
yeah the follow-up of the CDC
actually. When you're going to reduce the dose مثلا 100 milligram you're not going to get a real therapeutic effect
بس حضرتك اول ويسترن ليتريتشر
وكوميونتي ما بيستخدموش
لان الام ام اف بقى موجود لكن احنا ممكن عشان احنا ظروفنا الاقتصاديه
ايوه انا عشان بتكلم انا بتكلم عن
الفورتيشن
يعني اتس ا فيري جود دراج
ميبي
روبوكسي الوحيد اللي بيستخدمه مصر انا ده وكان حاجه ثالثه دي نيو دراج ويتش از هايبر ريسيميك actually it's also contraindicated إذا كنت هتقول يعني we should be taken very cautiously لما يكون بيستخدم azathioprine it has the same effect
yes.
the only advantage of this drug yes the only advantage of this drug is that you can use it in patients who have hypersensitivity to allopurinol.
It's only itself
not more effective
yes.
and it has the same effect as the azathioprine as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Jones.
Thank you.
Just for the metformin, I think the European best practice guidelines extend the use of metformin to even clearance of the GFR of less than 30 mg, just to reduce the dose of 500 mg.
Yes, less than 30. But there is a list of other complications pointed by Professor Shaisha. Cardiovascular, you said. Mortality.
Yes, it's mentioned. Yes, yes, I know.
My question to you is, do you have any particular regimen for diabetic patients who are going to transplantation in terms of the use of resin drug?
You would just treat the patient in the post-transplant period just like your approaches to type 2 diabetics. So you would follow the American Diabetic Association. You would definitely implement diet and lifestyle modification if this is possible. And you would start I wouldn't recommend to use metformin as an initial drug, but maybe you would use a DPP-4 inhibitor, who being Professor Damel and yourself in various meetings related to this drug.
You're the best drugs.
Yes, yes, there is no contraindication to use the DPP-4 inhibitors. Maybe I would like to recommend basal insulin is wonderful in the context of post-transplant transplantation here with the blood sugar, very sweet.
Asking about immunosuppressive medication, do you have any particular regimens for
diabetic
patients?
Oh yes, this is a difficult question. This is a very difficult question. If you are using tacrolimus, patidesnac, I would consider maybe shifting to CNI, but doing these maneuvers is really serious because you are jeopardizing the patient. You may get an acute rejection. Maybe I don't really have to reduce the immunosuppression for this particular point, because diabetes, I would say, is much easier in dealing with. We have a variety of drugs and dosage. I can even keep the patient. Although the literature says reduce. How am I going to reduce the CMI, whether cyclosporine or tacrolimus, and I may get a rejection? Maybe steroids. Yes. This is difficult.
أنا رأيي على فكرة
طبعا. هذه حاجة كلينيكا خالص الموضوع ده صعب. Yeah, you will treat the patient just like a type 2.
But أنا رأيي إن
there is protocols that
the presence of 1 week steroids and the stop.
You will reduce the steroids. Do you favor stopping steroids generally, Professor
Mahesh? Actually, not. We should not modify much in the use of recipe protocols that Kutarma people, and it's much easier to control the diabetes
yes.
by any maneuver.
No, I don't.
Not to jeopardize the outcome of the graft على أساس إن أنا
The presence of diabetes is much more serious than the occurrence of acute rejection.
If not controlled,
really?
But it is easy.
Of course.
If not controlled, of course.
What
are you doing in Mansoura, Dr. Hassan or Dr. Ashraf? Please.
Can you allow me just to ask one
question?
Last comment
from
Dr. Ashraf.
A diabetic patient with stable graft function, what are you doing towards his immunosuppression?
I think Dr. Ayman will present two slides. It will answer these questions.
اوكي ليتس جو.
طب عايز اقول حاجه للدكتور بعد اذنك. احنا اتفقنا ان مش هنستخدم الفورم من سواء سي كي دي او كارتش او كده ولا في كلام مش كده؟
1.6 المنشور عشان خاطر الدكتوره مي زودها شويه.
الحاجه الثانيه لو عين عامل ترانزيشن يلا اكيوت جاوتي اتاك هل بتستخدم الكوشيسين مع تيبشات ولا مستخدم الكوشيسين لوحده زي العادي يعني؟
الاكيد اتاك حاجه والتروفلكس حاجه
ما هو ده اللي انا قلته 3.6 مللي جرامز لغايه كل ست ساعات لغايه ما البين يروح او يعني يجي له توكسيسيتي او دايريا اند سو فورث والكوشيسين كوشيسين از ا وندرفول دراج بس الكومبليكيشن خطيره قوي دي يعني تخليك يعني وارد ميبي try to use the colchicine for a day or so. Steroids would ameliorate the pain and much more safer than colchicine. I really don't have a personal experience in treating gout in post-transplantation. I haven't come across it. Maybe it is common. We all know that we should have it. I don't know how frequent this you meet with. Maybe someone has some clinical experience in this particular point. You may have been, and I don't know.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.